You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Psychology 101. Today we're going to be finishing up chapter 11 on social psychology and moving into chapter 12 on psychological disorders, which more generally just refers to the field of clinical psychology. So let's pick up where we left off last time. We were in the middle of examining the last key question of chapter 11, and that was, how do systems create situations that influence behavior? This is the idea that systems and the way they are set up shape the situations that we're in, and that those situations in turn affect individual behavior in ways that sometimes we would never predict. We saw that throughout this chapter. Phil Zimbardo and others argue that if we can learn how to change a system, then we can modify the system's influence on us. In his TED talk, which is where we left off, he's specifically suggesting, again, I just want to remind you guys, that we don't necessarily always think of people in terms, and the heinous things they do, in terms of something being wrong with the individual. He said, so we don't think of people in terms of being bad apples, right? He said, instead, let's consider bad barrels or bad barrel makers to reflect both the social context, the situation, and the system that the situation is shaped by, respectively. So in doing so, he makes reference to his infamous Stanford prison study. This is, again, a classic study in the field of social psychology, and clarifies the importance of this work and the understanding of systems to everything from bullying to torture and to terrorism. And this topic is perhaps particularly relevant now given recent events, including the tragedy that happened at the Boston Marathon. So here is the rest of Zimbardo's TED talk on the psychology of evil. We can go ahead and cue the video.
Read the story, you watch the movie. This is Stanley Milgram, little Jewish kid from the Bronx, and he asked the question, could the Holocaust happen here now? People said, no, that's Nazi Germany, that's Hitler. You know, that's 1939. He said, yeah, but suppose Hitler asked you, would you electrocute a stranger? No way, not me, I'm a good person. He said, why don't we put you in a situation and give you a chance to see what you would do? And so what he did was he tested 1,000 ordinary people, 500 New Haven, Connecticut, 500 Bridgeport. And the ad said, psychologists want to understand memory. We want to improve people's memory because memory is a key to success, okay? We're going to give you $5, $4 for your time. And he said, we don't want college students. We want men between 20 and 50. In the latest studies, they ran women. Ordinary people, barbers, clerks, white-collar people. So you go down, and one of you is going to be a learner. One of you is going to be a teacher. The learner is a genial middle-aged guy. He gets tied up to the shock apparatus in another room. The learner could be the middle-aged, could be as young as 20. And one of you is told by the authority, the guy in the lab coat, your job as teacher is to give this guy material to learn. Gets it right, reward him. Gets it wrong, you press a button on the shock box. First button is 15 volts. He doesn't even feel it. That's the key. All evil starts with 15 volts. And then the next step is another 15 volts. The problem is, at the end of the line is 450 volts. And as you go along, the guy is screaming, I've got a heart condition, I'm out of here. You're a good person. You complain. Sir, who's going to be responsible if something happens to him? Experiment says, don't worry, I will be responsible. Go, continue, teacher. And the question is, who would go all the way to 450 volts? You should notice here, when it gets up to 375, it says danger, severe shock. When it gets up to here, there's triple X, the pornography of power. So Milgram asked 40 psychiatrists, what percent of American citizens would go to the end? They said only 1%, because that's sadistic behavior, and we know, psychiatry knows, only 1% of Americans are sadistic. Okay. Here's the data. They could not be more wrong. Two-thirds go all the way to 450 volts. This was just one study. Milgram did more than 16 studies. And look at this. In study 16, where you see somebody like you go all the way, 90% go all the way. In study 5, if you see people rebel, 90% rebel. What about women? Study 13, no different than men. So Milgram is quantifying evil as the willingness of people to blindly obey authority to go all the way to 450 volts. And it's like a dial on human nature, a dial in the sense that you can make almost everybody totally obedient, down to the majority, down to none. So what are the external parallels? All research is artificial. What's the validity in the real world? 912 American citizens committed suicide or were murdered by family and friends in Guyana jungle in 1978 because they were blindly obedient to this guy, their pastor, not the priest, their pastor, Reverend Jim Jones. He persuaded them to commit mass suicide. And so he's the modern Lucifer effect, a man of God who becomes the angel of death. Milgram's study is all about individual authority to control people. Most of the time, we are in institutions. So the Stanford Prison Study is a study of the power of institutions to influence individual behavior. Interestingly, Stanley Milgram and I were in the same high school class in James Monroe in the Bronx, 1954. So this study, which I did with my graduate students, especially Craig Haney, we also began with an ad. We didn't have money, so we had a cheap little ad. But we wanted college students for a study of prison life. 75 people volunteered, took personality tests, we did interviews, picked 24, most normal, most healthy, randomly assigned them to be prison and guard. So on day one, we knew we had good apples. I'm going to put them in a bad situation. And secondly, we know there's no difference between the boys who are going to be guards, the boys who are going to be prisoners. The kids who are going to be prisoners, they said, wait at home in the dormitories, the study will begin Sunday. We didn't tell them that the city police were going to come and do realistic arrests.
Car pulls up in front, and a cop comes to the front door, knocks, and says he's looking for me. So they, right there, they took me out the door, they put my hands against the car. It was a real cop car, it was a real policeman, and there were real neighbors in the street who didn't know that I was, this was an experiment. And there was cameras all around and neighbors all around. They put me in the car, then they drove me around Palo Alto. They took me to the police station, the basement of the police station. Then they put me in a cell. I was the first one to be picked up, so they put me in a cell, which was just like a room with a door with bars on it. You could tell it wasn't a real jail. They locked me in there in this degrading little outfit. They were taking this experiment too seriously.
Here are the prisoners who are going to be dehumanized. They're going to become numbers. Here are the guards with the symbols of power and anonymity. Guards get prisoners to clean the toilet bowls out their bare hands, to do other humiliating tasks. They strip them naked. They sexually taunt them. They begin to do degrading activities, like having them simulate sodomy. You saw simulating fellatio in soldiers in Abu Ghraib. My guards did it in 5 days. The stress reaction was so extreme that normal kids we've picked because they're healthy had breakdowns within 36 hours. The study ended after 6 days because it was out of control. 5 kids had emotional breakdowns. Does it make a difference if warriors go to battle, changing their appearance or not? Does it make a difference if they're anonymous in how they treat their victims? We know in some cultures they go to war, they don't change appearance. In other cultures, they paint themselves like Lord of the Flies. In some, they wear masks. In many, they wear soldiers are anonymous in uniform. So with this anthropologist, John Watson, found 23 cultures that had 2 bits of data. Do they change their appearance? 15. Do they kill, torture, mutilate? 13. If they don't change their appearance, only 1 of 8 kills, torture, mutilate. The key is in the red zone. If they change their appearance, 12 of 13, that's 90%, kill, torture, mutilate. And that's the power of anonymity. So what are the seven social processes that grease the slippery slope of evil? Mindlessly taking the first small step. Dehumanization of others. Deindividuation of self. Diffusion of personal responsibility. Blind obedience to authority. Uncritical conformity to group norms. Passive tolerance of evil through inaction or indifference. And it happens when you're in a new or unfamiliar situation. Your habitual response patterns don't work. Your personality and morality are disengaged. Nothing is easier than to denounce the evildoer. Nothing more difficult than understanding him, Dostoevsky tells us. Understanding is not excusing. Psychology is not excusiology. So social psychological research reveals how ordinary good people can be transformed without the drugs. You don't need it. You just need the social psychological processes. Real world parallels. Compare this with this. James Schlesinger, and I'm going to have to end with this, says, psychologists have attempted to understand how and why individuals and groups who usually act humanely can sometimes act otherwise in certain circumstances. That's the Lucifer effect. And he goes on to say, the landmark Stanford study provides a cautionary tale for all military operations. If you give people power without oversight, it's a prescription for abuse. They knew that and let that happen. So another report, investigative report by General Fay, says the system is guilty. And in this report he says, it was the environment created Abu Ghraib by leadership failures that contributed to the occurrence of such abuse. And the fact that it remained undiscovered by higher authorities for a long period of time. Those abuses went on for 3 months. Who was watching the store? The answer is nobody. And I think nobody on purpose. He gave the guards permission to do those things and they knew nobody was ever going to come down to that dungeon. So you need a paradigm shift in all of these areas. The shift is away from the medical model that focuses only on the individual. And the shift is toward a public health model that recognizes situational and systemic vectors of disease. Bullying is a disease, prejudice is a disease, violence is a disease, and since the Inquisition, we've been dealing with problems at the individual level. And you know what? It doesn't work. Alexander Solzhenitsyn says the line between good and evil cuts through the heart of every human being. That means that line is not out there. That's a decision that you have to make. That's a personal thing. So I want to end very quickly on a positive note. Heroism as the antidote to evil. By promoting the heroic imagination, especially in our kids, in our educational system, we want kids to think, I'm a hero in waiting, waiting for the right situation to come along, and I will act heroically. My whole life is now going to focus away from evil that I've been in since I was a kid to understanding heroes. The banality of heroism is it's ordinary people who do heroic deeds. It's the counterpoint to Hannah Arendt's banality of evil. Our traditional societal heroes are wrong because they are the exception. They organize their whole life around this. That's why we know their names. And our kids' heroes are also wrong models for them because they have supernatural talents. We want our kids to realize most heroes are everyday people. And the heroic act is unusual. This is Joe Darby. He was the one that stopped those abuses you saw because when he saw those images, he turned them over to a senior investigating officer. He was a low-level private, and that stopped it. Was he a hero? No. They had to put him in hiding because people wanted to kill him and then his mother and his wife. For 3 years, they were in hiding. This is the woman who stopped the Stanford prison study. And I said it got out of control. I was a prison superintendent. I didn't know it was out of control. I was totally indifferent. She came down, saw that madhouse, and said, you know what? It's terrible what you're doing to those boys. They're not prisoners, they're not guards, they're boys, and you are responsible. And I ended the study the next day. The good news is I married her the next year. I just came to my senses, obviously. So situations have the power to do the same, but the point is, it's the same situation that can inflame the hostile imagination in some of us that makes us perpetrators of evil, can inspire the heroic imagination in others. It's the same situation, and you're on one side or the other. Most people are guilty of the evil of inaction because your mother says, don't get involved, mind your own business. And you have to say, Mama, humanity is my business. So the psychology of heroism is, we're going to end in a moment, how do we encourage children in new hero courses that I'm working with Matt Langdon, he has a hero workshop, to develop this heroic imagination, this self-labeling, I am a hero in waiting, and teach them skills. To be a hero, you have to learn to be a deviant because you're always going against the conformity of the group. Heroes are ordinary people whose social action is extraordinary, who act The key to heroes is two things. You have to act when other people are passive. B, you have to act sociocentrically, not egocentrically. And I want to end with a story that some of you know about, Wesley Autry, New York subway hero, 50-year-old African-American construction worker. He's standing on a subway in New York. A white guy falls on the tracks. The subway train is coming. There are 75 people there. You know what? They freeze. He's got a reason not to get involved. He's black, the guy's white, and he's got two little kids. Instead, he gives his kids to a stranger, jumps on the tracks, puts the guy between the tracks, lays on him, the subway goes over him. Wesley and the guy, 20 and a half inches height. The train clearance is 21 inches. A half an inch would have taken his head off. And he said, I did what anyone could do, no big deal to jump on the tracks, and the moral imperative is, I did what everyone should do. And so one day, you will be in a new situation. Take path one, you're going to be a perpetrator of evil. Evil meaning you're going to be Arthur Anderson, you're going to cheat, or you're going to allow bullying. Path two, you become guilty of the evil of passive inaction. Path three, you become a hero. The point is, are we ready to take the path to celebrating ordinary heroes, waiting for the right situation to come along to put heroic imagination into action? Because it may only happen once in your life. When you pass it by, you'll always know, I could have been a hero, and I let it pass me by. So the point is thinking it and then doing it. So I want to thank you, thank you, thank you. Let's oppose the power of evil systems at home and abroad. And let's focus on the positive. Advocate for respect of personal dignity, for justice and peace, which sadly our administration has not been doing. Thanks so much.
Okay, welcome back. So again, the bottom line here is, from this perspective, is really that to change undesirable behavior, it's not enough to punish individuals. The system has to be examined and improved as well. And as I alluded to before, you might begin to wonder about the recent events in Boston during the marathon when we experienced the bombings that happened there. Authorities are clearly still in the process of gathering evidence about the suspects in question, but there is some information to suggest that they're from a country that has a history of oppression and violence. So without ignoring the personal responsibility or the tragedy of this incident, we can begin to wonder, from perhaps this newly acquired lens, what were the systems that might have created the situations that impacted the particular actions that these individuals took? So what we're going to do now is actually shift into a particular kind of system in the next chapter, chapter 12. And the system we're going to be examining here is the system for classifying psychological disorders. And we'll start with the first key question of the chapter, and that is, what is psychological disorder? So the answer is that different people have different answers to this question. They answer this question in different ways. And this is in part because distinguishing between what is, quote, normal, unquote, and what is abnormal is not straightforward, to say the least. And as we found in the last chapter, it's important to question authority in some cases, blindly accepting what the group or some perceived authority says about something is dangerous. We know this. So it behooves us to ask the question, who is defining what is normal and abnormal and why? And further, you know, who are these people and do we authorize them to make such distinctions? Okay. So before we go into answering those questions, rather difficult questions actually, let's examine what we're being told about psychological disorder. There's really two main views of what it is in Western culture, coming from the medical model and then the psychological model. So the medical model views psychological disorder as diseases. So depression is really no different from diabetes from this perspective. Whereas the psychological view looks at the interaction of biological, behavioral, cognitive, developmental, and social processes. A brief tour of the historical roots of psychological disorder and how it's been conceived over time, you know, from demonic possession to witchcraft to food poisoning to whatever, demonstrates that it's always changing. So there have been changing concepts of psychological disorder over time, and we've had to learn from our past mistakes, and some of this learning has been hard. So to think we have it right here in 2013 would be, well, probably rather absurd. It's at best a work in slow progress. That said, it was really only in the 18th century, sort of echoing Hippocrates' view of mental illness having physical causes, that the medical model reemerged. Again, and this is the view that mental disorders are diseases that, like ordinary physical diseases, have objective physical causes and require specific kinds of treatments. So when we view psychological disorder from this perspective, using this model, it's actually led to a lot of important things, like the establishment of asylums in the past, for example, or mental hospitals nowadays. These are places, at least in theory, where people with mental disease are to be protected and supported. But the medical model also comes with certain drawbacks, and they can include, number one, the assumption that disease can lead to the sort of doctor knows best approach, right? Patients are sometimes treated only with pills, and psychiatrists, so these are medical doctors specializing in the treatment of mental disease, become the dominant figure in the treatment of mental illness. Psychologists believe that this attitude wrongly encourages dependency and on doctors, and may encourage unnecessary taking of medications to treat mental illness, as opposed to, or sometimes in the place of, developing good coping skills and other kinds of healthy behaviors. So we really want to take a look at those treatment alternatives too, when we're thinking about somebody with a psychological disorder. So in place of the medical model, the psychological model, and so most clinical psychologists sort of have this view of a combined set of influences. And this comes from all of the different subfields of psychology that we have discussed thus far in this course. Behaviorism, cognitive psychology, developmental psychology, social learning, and biological psychology too. So just by way of review, but also somewhat new as applied to explaining psychological disorder, which is the topic of this chapter, we can look at the biological perspective. A biological perspective is required to account for the genetic influences, you know, which we know are there. I mean, those are, they're very clearly seen in certain mental health conditions like bipolar disorder, schizophrenia. And this is true specifically for genetic influences on our brain structure and function more generally, but also how the brain and its mental functions are dependent to some extent on, to a large extent, on the balance of certain neurochemicals and neural circuits that are continually being modified and shaped by our experience. So we also have the behavioral perspective. The behavioral perspective, looking outward, looking at the influence of the environment on how we think, how we feel, what we do. The cognitive perspective, looking inward, right? Emphasizing things, our mental processes, like our thoughts, our feelings, our perceptions, our memory, and our sense of control or not, right? So how much control do we feel we have in any given situation? Is our fate up to us or some other forces outside of us? And sense cognition and behavior occur in a social context, which we just examined in the last chapter, the social perspective links in. So we can look at the social environment and its impact on us. And finally, the developmental perspective, right? This looks for deviations in what's expected, what's the expected pattern of biological or psychosocial development. So taken together, this is known as the biopsychosocial model for understanding psychological disorder, and mental health, mental ill health. So stated more simply, we know that both nature and nurture play a role, right? This has been a common theme throughout our entire semester thus far. So many psychological disorders can be conceptualized from this perspective and using what's called the diathesis stress model. So essentially, this just means that psychological disorder is the result of both our biological predispositions and our life experience. So we may have a genetic vulnerability, here's an example, to become an alcoholic. But we may or may not actually become an alcoholic depending upon how stressful our life experience actually is. So two people with the same genetic predisposition, maybe one goes on to develop alcohol abuse or alcohol dependency and the other doesn't, because the first person has more stressful life experiences, tipping them over the threshold for the development of the disorder. So that's how we would understand psychopathology or psychological disorder from the diathesis stress model. There are these competing views of psychological disorder, but underlying both views is an assumption, right? And that assumption is that we can define abnormality, or that a certain group can define abnormality for us, right? So one question that we can entertain is, are mental health professionals capable of reliably distinguishing abnormality from normality? And if so, how? And related to this question is the question of abnormality more generally, you know, which I think is a great topic actually for our next discussion board. So what I'd like to do is to have discussion board number 7 be about this topic. So the question specifically is, what does it mean to be abnormal? Are things that seem abnormal to you also abnormal to me, and vice versa? Who should define what is abnormal? If something is abnormal, does it make it wrong? All right, so these are all really important questions, and I'm hoping that by the end of the class today that you're gonna have some ideas about this that you wanna share with one another. So I'll look forward to hearing from you about that. But in the meantime, let's get back to the original question I posed. Are mental health professionals capable of reliably distinguishing abnormality from normality? And if so, how? And to answer this question, I'm going to introduce to you the very famous study by Rosenhan, written up in the article on being sane in insane places. It's a great title, I know. So this is arguably the best known and most controversial paper in all of what we call abnormal psychology. So for those of you who are going to take other psychology courses, and those specifically related to the field of clinical psychology, the course that you're likely to take is going to be entitled Abnormal Psychology. And you'll undoubtedly hear about Rosenhan's study once again. But the methodology of the study was actually quite simple. 8 pseudo patients, and these are just, pseudo patients are just normal people feigning mental illness. Okay, so 8 pseudo patients, including Rosenhan himself, obtained admission to 12 psychiatric hospitals by simulating symptoms of mental illness. Specifically, what they did, they told admitting personnel that they were hearing voices, and these voices were saying the words empty, hollow, and thud. All of them were admitted to the psychiatric hospitals, and mostly they were diagnosed with schizophrenia, and they were eventually discharged. But there were a number of remarkable things that were noted throughout the course of this study. First, once admitted to the hospital, the pseudo patients immediately stopped complaining of their symptoms, right? They denied they were hearing voices and further denied any other kind of psychiatric symptomatology. Nevertheless, they were kept in the hospital for several weeks in most cases, and many were discharged with the diagnosis schizophrenia in remission. So in remission just means that no symptoms were present at the time of their discharge. But the label schizophrenia stuck, right? It didn't become no diagnosis. It was schizophrenia in remission, even though their symptoms just came and went. Second thing, other patients on the wards would accuse these patients of being, quote, normal. They recognized them as pseudo patients. They'd say things like, you know, you're not crazy. You're a journalist or a professor checking up on the hospital or something like that. So the other patients could tell that these were just pseudo patients. Again, just individuals who were feigning mental illness. But the staff of the hospital did not recognize or speak to this, suggesting to Rosenhan that the psychiatric labels became self-fulfilling prophecies, right? As evidenced by the fact that certain kinds of commonplace behaviors that they were demonstrating on the ward were being interpreted as signs of mental illness. So, you know, note-taking maybe being interpreted as a sign of paranoia, or pacing back and forth being a sign of nervousness, you know, as opposed to boredom. So these innocuous habits that many of us exhibit from time to time, you know, twirling our hair under stress, muttering to ourselves while we're reading, you know, whatever, you know, can be construed by others as indicators of psychological abnormality given the right context. So what Rosenhan suggested is really profound when you think about it. He's suggesting that, number one, mental health professionals cannot reliably distinguish the sane from the insane. And number two, that psychiatric labels have extremely deleterious or negative effects on people. Now, there have been a lot of criticisms, of course, of this study, including the fact that, you know, people say, well, the patients didn't behave normally in the hospital. People don't normally lie about their symptoms to gain admission to a mental hospital. Had their behavior been truly normal, they would have, you know, walked up to the nurse's station and said something like, look, I'm a person who just tried to see if I could get in here by behaving crazy, but it, you know, it worked, but now I need to be discharged. I said that would be normal behavior. But Rosenhan countered these arguments by saying psychiatrists should have detected the lying. Another criticism of the study was around the fact that these individuals were discharged with a diagnosis of schizophrenia or bipolar disorder in remission. You know, they say that this is actually very rare for this to happen, that most schizophrenics are usually still somewhat symptomatic upon discharge. So the fact that the psychiatrists were willing to report this diagnosis suggests that they were not being influenced or led by anything other than what they were really seeing in front of them. A third criticism of the study, admitting personnel all made what we refer to as false positive errors, calling a healthy person ill, as opposed to a false negative error, which would be calling an ill person healthy, right? And they say that it's better to have false positive errors than false negative errors, particularly in the case of trying to identify a disorder as serious as schizophrenia, because failure to make that diagnosis or to detect that the disorder is there could lead to really serious consequences. So the argument is made that the psychiatrists in Rosenhan's study were really using very good scientific professional judgment. But the results, though, do lead us to the stark reality that, you know, we are human and therefore we have biases, including the tendency to interpret behavior contextually, right? So as to achieve a consistency between what we already believe or what we expect to believe and what we're currently seeing. It's why we make research assistants blind to a study protocol, you know, because, or the groups to which, you know, people belong in a research study, you know, because we see what we think we're going to see oftentimes. So this underscores the hazards of, or at least one of the hazards of diagnostic labeling, and begins to answer the second key question of this chapter, chapter 12, which is, what are the consequences of labeling people? one answer, they can become self-fulfilling prophecies. It also underscores Rosenhan's study, the irreversibility of such labels, right? So again, even though the initial diagnosis of these patients in his study was in error, the final diagnosis still remained in remission, schizophrenia in remission, bipolar disorder in remission, versus no diagnosis at all. It's as if the diagnostician can never be wrong in some way. Okay, so why do we use labels in the first place then? You know, you might be asking yourself at this point. Well, ideally, you know, if we can accurately diagnose somebody, that's going to lead to proper treatment. It's going to lead to the person getting the help that they need. But this process of labeling people has certain consequences, right? It can lead to a number of things. I want to just point out a few of these dangers or consequences of labeling people. Number one, as we've already discussed, the label can linger, right? It can linger on as a stigma long after the condition is treated. So a mistaken physical diagnosis can be retracted, right? You know, you can sort of have that sort of off your slate or your record, but a mistaken mental diagnosis is almost never retracted. It remains. Labeling can deprive people of their identity and individuality. Okay, like depersonalizes them in some way. And this can result from both labeling and also stays in a mental hospital. And third, and maybe most importantly, labeling can lead to the self-fulfilling prophecies we talked about and or the exercise or abuse of power, right? So there's a psychiatrist, Thomas Zaz, who has a really important message, I think, for those of us studying abnormal psychology or psychological disorder. He goes so far as to say that labeling is just another way to marginalize people who are exhibiting behaviors that the majority, so most of us, don't like or that we don't know how to make sense of, right? In fact, he's been very outspoken in declaring that mental illness is merely a myth, that it doesn't exist, and that we'd be better off if we just called these kinds of behavioral patterns that we see and label in people as problems in living or something like that, to reflect that they're really only a problem to the extent that they are a mismatch with the social or cultural context in which they arise, right? So if they were seen as non-problematic, they wouldn't be considered disease processes, meaning they wouldn't be considered illnesses at all, right? They would just be less frequently seen versions of what it means to be human in the world. So perhaps a spokesperson for this view might be a woman. This is an autism activist named Temple Grandin. So this is a woman who is actually diagnosed with autism. She's very high functioning. And in this TED talk you're about to see, she explains how her mind works and her ability to think in pictures, which she says helps her solve problems. And I love this term, helps her solve problems that neurotypical brains might miss. So she makes a case, basically, for why the world needs people on the autism spectrum. So this is her TED talk entitled, "The World Needs All Kinds of Minds." We can go ahead and cue this video.
I think I'll start out and just talk a little bit about what exactly autism is. Autism is a very big continuum that goes from very severe, the child remains nonverbal, all the way up to brilliant scientists and engineers. And I actually feel at home here because there's a lot of autism genetics here. You wouldn't have any... It's a continuum of traits. When does a nerd turn into, you know, Asperger, which is just mild autism. I mean, Einstein and Mozart and Tesla would all be probably diagnosed as autistic spectrum today. And one of the things that really is going to concern me is getting these kids to be the ones that are going to invent the next energy things, now that Bill Gates talked about this morning. Okay, now if you want to understand autism animals, and I want to talk to you about different ways of thinking, you have to get away from verbal language. I think in pictures. I don't think in language. Now, the thing about the autistic mind is it attends to details. Okay, this is a test where you either have to pick out the big letters or pick out the little letters, and the autistic mind picks out the little letters more quickly. And the thing is, the normal brain ignores the details. Well, if you're building a bridge, details are pretty important because it'll fall down if you ignore the details. And one of my big concerns with a lot of policy things today is things are getting too abstract. People are getting away from doing hands-on stuff. I'm really concerned that a lot of the schools have taken out the hands-on classes because art and classes like that, those were the classes where I excelled. Okay, in my work with cattle, I noticed a lot of little things that most people don't notice would make the cattle balk. Like, for example, this flag waving right in front of the veterinary facility. This feed yard was going to tear down their whole veterinary facility. All they needed to do was move the flag. Rapid movement, contrast. In the early 70s, when I started, I got right down in the chutes to see what cattle were seeing. People thought that was crazy. A coat on a fence would make them balk. Shadows would make them balk. A hose on the floor. People weren't noticing these things. A chain hanging down. And that's shown very, very nicely in the movie. In fact, I loved the movie how they duplicated all my projects. That's the geek side. My drawings got the star in the movie, too. And actually, it's called Temple Grandin, not Thinking in Pictures. So what is Thinking in Pictures? It's literally movies in your head. My mind works like Google for images. Now, when I was a young kid, I didn't know my thinking was different. I thought everybody thought in pictures. And then when I did my book, Thinking in Pictures, I started interviewing people about how they think. And I was shocked to find out that my thinking was quite different. Like if I say, think about a church steeple, most people get this sort of generalized, generic one. Now, maybe that's not true in this room, but it's going to be true in a whole lot of different places. I see only specific pictures. They flash up into my memory just like Google for pictures. And in the movie, they've got a great scene in there where the word shoe is said and a whole bunch of 50s and 60s shoes pop into my imagination. Okay, there's my childhood church. That's specific. There's some more. Fort Collins. Okay, how about famous ones? And they just kind of come up kind of like this, just really quickly, like Google for pictures. And they come up one at a time. And then I can think, well, okay, well, maybe we can have it snow or we can have a thunderstorm. I can hold it there and turn them into videos. Now, visual thinking was a tremendous asset in my work designing cattle handling facilities. And I've worked really hard on improving how cattle are treated at the slaughter plant. I'm not going to go into any gucky slaughter slides. I've got that stuff up on YouTube if you want to look at it. But one of the things that I was able to do in my design work is I could actually test run a piece of equipment in my mind, just like a virtual reality computer system. And this is an aerial view of a recreation of one of my projects that was used in the movie. That was like just so super cool. And there were a lot of kind of Asperger types and autism types working out there on the movie set, too. But one of the things that really worries me is where's the younger version of those kids going today? They're not ending up in Silicon Valley where they belong. Now, one of the things I learned very early on, because I wasn't that social, is I had to sell my work and not myself. And the way I sold livestock jobs is I showed off my drawings, I showed off pictures of things. Another thing that helped me as a little kid is, boy, in the 50s you were taught manners. You were taught you can't pull the merchandise off the shelves in the store and throw it around. Now, when kids get to be in third or fourth grade, you might see that this kid's going to be a visual thinker, drawing in perspective. Now, I want to emphasize that not every autistic kid's going to be a visual thinker. Now, I had this brain scan done several years ago, and I used to joke around about having a gigantic internet trunk line going deep into my visual cortex. This is tensor imaging. And my great big internet trunk line is twice as big as the controls. The red lines there are me, and the blue lines are the sex and age matched control. And there I got a gigantic one, and the control over there, the blue one, has got a really small one. And some of the research now is showing that people on the spectrum actually think with primary visual cortex. Now the thing is, the visual thinker is just one kind of mind. You see, the autistic mind tends to be a specialist mind, good at one thing, bad at something else. And where I was bad was algebra. And I was never allowed to take geometry or trig. Gigantic mistake. I'm finding a lot of kids that need to skip algebra, go right to geometry and trig. Now another kind of mind is the pattern thinker, more abstract. These are your engineers, your computer programmers. Now this is pattern thinking. That praying mantis is made from a single sheet of paper. No scotch tape, no cuts, and there in the background is the pattern for folding it. Here are the types of thinking. Photorealistic visual thinkers like me, pattern thinkers, music and math minds. Some of these oftentimes have problems with reading. You also will see these kind of problems with kids that are dyslexic. You'll see these different kinds of minds. And then there's a verbal mind. They know every fact about everything. Now another thing is the sensory issues. I was really concerned about having to wear this gadget on my face. And I came in half an hour beforehand so I could have it put on and kind of get used to it, and they got it bent so it's not hitting my chin. But sensory is an issue. Some kids are bothered by fluorescent lights. Others have problems with sound sensitivity. You know, it's going to be variable. Now, visual thinking gave me a whole lot of insight into the animal mind. Because think about it, an animal's a sensory-based thinker, not verbal. Thinks in pictures. Thinks in sounds. Thinks in smells. Think about how much information there is there on the local fire hydrant. He knows who's been there, when they were there. Are they friend or foe? Is there anybody he can go mate with? There's a ton of information on that fire hydrant. It's all very detailed information. And looking at these kind of details gave me a lot of insight into animals. Now, the animal mind, and also my mind, puts sensory-based information into categories. Man on a horse and a man on the ground, that is viewed as two totally different things. You can have a horse that's been abused by a rider. They'll be absolutely fine with the veterinarian and with the horseshoer, but you can't ride them. You have another horse where maybe the horseshoer beat him up, and he'll be terrible for anything on the ground with the veterinarian, but a person can ride him. Cattle are the same way. Man on a horse, a man on foot, they're two different things. You see, it's a different picture. See, I want you to think about just how specific this is. Now, this ability to put information into categories, I find a lot of people are not very good at this. Like when I'm out troubleshooting with equipment or problems with something in a plant, they don't seem to be able to figure out, do I have a training people issue or do I have something wrong with the equipment? In other words, categorize equipment problem from a people problem. I find a lot of people have difficulty doing that. Now, let's say I figure out, is it an equipment problem? Is it a minor problem with something simple I can fix? Or is the whole design of the system wrong? People have a hard time figuring that out. Let's just look at something like, you know, solving problems with, you know, making airlines safer. Yeah, I'm a million-mile flyer. I do lots and lots of flying. And, you know, like if I was at the FFA, what would I be doing a lot of direct observation of? It would be their airplane tails. You know, 5 fatal wrecks in the last 20 years. Tail either came off or steering stuff inside the tail broke in some way. It's tails, pure and simple. And when the pilots walk around the plane, guess what? They can't see that stuff inside the tail. You know, now as I think about that, I'm pulling up all of that, you know, specific information. It's specific. See, my thinking's bottom up. I take all the little pieces and I put the pieces together like a puzzle. Now here's a horse that was deathly afraid of black cowboy hats. He'd been abused by somebody with a black cowboy hat. White cowboy hats, that was absolutely fine. Now the thing is, the world is gonna need all of the different kinds of minds to work together. We've got to work on developing all these different kinds of minds. And one of the things that's driving me really crazy as I travel around and I do autism meetings is I'm seeing a lot of smart, geeky, nerdy kids, and they just aren't very social, and nobody's working on developing their interest in something like science. And this brings up the whole thing of my science teacher. My science teacher is shown absolutely beautifully in the movie. I was a goofball student when I was in high school. I just didn't care at all about studying until I had Mr. Carlock's science class. He was now Dr. Carlock in the movie. And he got me challenged to figure out an optical illusion room. This brings up the whole thing of you got to show kids interesting stuff. You know, one of the things that I think maybe TED ought to do is tell all the schools about all the great lectures that are on TED. And there's all kinds of great stuff on the internet to get these kids turned on. Because I'm seeing a lot of these geeky, nerdy kids, and the teachers out in the Midwest and other parts of the country, when you get away from these tech areas, they don't know what to do with these kids. And they're not going down the right path. The thing is, you can make a mind to be more of a thinking and cognitive mind, or a mind can be wired to be more social. And what some of the research now has shown in autism is there may be extra wiring back here in the really brilliant mind, and we lose a few social circuits here. It's kind of a trade-off between thinking and social. And then you can get into the point where it's so severe, you're going to have a person that's going to be nonverbal. In the normal human mind, language covers up the visual thinking we share with animals. This is the work of Dr. Bruce Miller, and he studied Alzheimer's patients that had frontal temporal lobe dementia. And the dementia ate out the language parts of the brain, and then this artwork came out of somebody that used to install stereos in cars. Now, Van Gogh doesn't know anything about physics, but I think it's very interesting that there was some work done to show that this eddy pattern in this painting followed a statistical model of turbulence. This brings up the whole interesting idea of maybe some of this mathematical patterns is in our own head. And the Wolfram stuff, I was taking notes and I was writing down all the search words I could use, because I think that's going to go on in my autism lectures. We've got to show these kids interesting stuff. And they've taken out the auto shop class and the drafting class and the art class. I mean, art was my best subject in school. We've got to think about all these different kinds of minds, and we've got to absolutely work with these kind of minds, because we absolutely are going to need these kind of people in the future. And let's talk about jobs. Okay, my science teacher got me studying because I was a goofball that didn't want to study. But you know what? I was getting work experience. I'm seeing too many of these smart kids that haven't learned basic things, like how to be on time. I was taught that when I was 8 years old. You know, how to have table manners at Granny's Sunday party. I was taught that when I was very, very young. And when I was 13, I had a job at a dressmaker's shop sewing clothes. I did internships in college. I was building things, and I also had to learn how to do assignments. You know, all I wanted to do was draw pictures of horses when I was little. Mother said, well, let's do a picture of something else. They've got to learn how to do something else. Let's say the kid's fixated on Legos. Let's get them working on building different things. The thing about the autistic mind is it tends to be fixated. Like if the kid loves race cars, let's use race cars for math. Let's figure out how long it takes a race car to go a certain distance. In other words, use that fixation in order to motivate that kid. That's one of the things we need to do. I really get fed up when the teachers, especially when you get away from this part of the country, they don't know what to do with these smart kids. It just drives me crazy. What can visual thinkers do when they grow up? They can do graphic design, all kinds of stuff with computers, photography, industrial design. The pattern thinkers, they're the ones that are going to be your mathematicians, your software engineers, your computer programmers, all of those kinds of jobs. And then you've got the word minds. They make great journalists. And they also make really, really good stage actors. Because the thing about being autistic is I had to learn social skills like being in a play. You just have to learn it. And we need to be working with these students. And this brings up mentors. You know, my science teacher was not an accredited teacher. He was a NASA space scientist. Now, some states now are getting it to where if you have a degree in biology or a degree in chemistry, you can come into the school and teach, you know, biology or chemistry. We need to be doing that. Because what I'm observing is the good teachers for a lot of these kids are out in the community colleges. But we need to be getting some of these good teachers into the high schools. Another thing that can be very, very, very successful is there's a lot of people that may have retired from, you know, working in the software industry. And they can teach a kid. And it doesn't matter if what they teach them is old. Because what you're doing is you're lighting the spark. You're getting that kid turned on. And you get them turned on, then he'll learn all the new stuff. Mentors are just essential. I cannot emphasize enough what my science teacher did for me. and we've got to mentor them, hire them. And if you bring them in for internships in your companies, the thing about the autism Asperger-y kind of mind, you got to give them a specific task. Don't just say design new software. You got to tell them something a lot more specific. Well, we're designing software for a phone, and it has to do some specific thing, and it can only use so much memory. That's the kind of specificity you need. Well, that's the end of my talk, and I just want to thank everybody for coming.
Okay, welcome back. So I hope the message that you're taking from this, I think the message is that if we can understand the minds of individuals with psychological disorders, then we can change the systems in which they live, in which they work, to better suit the particular pattern of strengths and weaknesses that we're seeing. With all these caveats in mind, let's begin to explore more closely the way that most of the Western world classifies psychological disorder. I'm going to start by asking you to consider a few questions for illustration. So, do you think any of these behaviors are abnormal? And then first answer that question, and then I want you to think about why or why not. So first, being unable to sleep, eat, or study after a breakup of a relationship. Is this abnormal? Why or why not? How about breaking into a cold sweat at the thought of being trapped in an elevator? Refusing to eat solid food for 4 days in order to stay slim. And now let me qualify this question by saying, how about if I'm talking about a woman in Southern California and it's 4 days before her wedding day? Normal or abnormal? Why or why not? How about swearing, throwing pillows, and pounding the wall during an argument? Washing your hands after riding a bus? Maybe washing your hands 2 or 3 times after riding a bus. How about believing that the government may be listening to your phone calls? And then I'll qualify that by saying, how about believing the government may be listening to your phone calls post 9/11? How about drinking a 6-pack of beer every day in order to be social with friends after work? How about a person talking to themselves as they're walking down a street? And then I'll ask you to think about that question again with the understanding that we're talking about prior to cell phones, prior to Bluetooth technology. Okay. What I'm hoping that you're seeing is that the answer to a lot of these questions is really that it depends, right? And, you know, I'm not sure exactly what criteria you were using to answer those questions, but a lot of times people will use the following criteria. They'll say, well, is something frequently occurring? You know, how often does it happen? If it happens a lot, then maybe that's normal. So statistical frequency would be the criterion from that perspective. Or we could say, well, is it consistent with cultural or societal norms or expectations? If it's consistent with the rest of the herd, then we say, yes, that's normal. And if it's not, we say no. Or we could look at the questions I just posed as, well, are they something that, is it something that's adaptive for the person? Is it harming the person or anyone else around them? We could look at it from that perspective. And all of these are particular ways of defining abnormality. But again, in every case, it really does depend on time and place. There are a ton of examples throughout history of behaviors that were once considered abnormal and no longer are classified as such. I mean, it used to be the case that nose piercing and bungee jumping were abnormal kinds of behaviors. Or in terms of, you know, actually diagnosed mental disorders, in our history, there was a diagnosable mental disorder called drapetomania. This is the disorder of slaves trying to seek freedom from their masters. More recently, homosexuality. It's true that up until 1973, homosexuality was listed in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, known as the DSM. We'll talk about that in just a minute. It was listed as a sexual deviation. So are we just labeling, again, back to Thomas Saz, are we just labeling behavior as abnormal when it goes against what the culture or the situation dictates to be normal at any given period of time? This is a tremendously important question for us to consider when we talk about psychological disorder. And so now that we have some sense that this concept of normality is in fact a relative concept, let's talk more specifically about the ways in which we could define abnormality and maybe what some of their advantages are and what some of their drawbacks are, regardless of whether we agree with them or not. You know, so we could say, for example, that a person's behavior is abnormal to the extent that it causes them distress. This is one way of defining it. Does the person show unusual or prolonged levels of distress or dis-ease, right? One problem with this definition of abnormality is that while some forms of mental illness certainly do cause distress, like anxiety and depression, which you've read about in this chapter, both disorders are likely to cause a person a significant amount of distress. I mean, by definition, they are distressing. But persons diagnosed with other kinds of disorders don't necessarily feel distress, like antisocial personality disorder. The so-called psychopaths, they don't necessarily feel distress until they're caught, perhaps. They're usually quite comfortable psychologically or emotionally. Also, some forms of mental retardation don't necessarily produce the kind of misery that a person with depression might experience either. If we have time, we're going to see a case example of a gentleman diagnosed with bipolar disorder and follow his experience. And in this particular case, it serves as another good example of someone with a mental illness diagnosed with a psychological disorder who's not necessarily distressed about it. In fact, he quite likes the periods of elation or natural highs that he gets as a result of his bipolar illness. So distress is one indicator of abnormality. Maladaptiveness is another one. So we could define abnormality as the extent to which an individual's behavior is maladaptive or interfering with their life in some way. Either in terms of interpersonal relationships or at work, at school, or how they use their leisure time, just some aspect of their daily life it interferes with. One problem with this definition by itself is that people are sometimes really good at hiding things, and they're really good at sort of reorganizing or structuring their life so as to include enough space for their behaviors that others might define as abnormal. For example, many people with obsessive compulsive disorder, this is one of the six anxiety disorders, they just adjust their lives to include the time they need for their ritualistic kinds of behaviors, or otherwise known as compulsions. They come to view it as just part of their lives. People with certain kinds of specific phobias, like fear of flying, for example, they can get around that by just traveling if they need to by train or by bus. So you're getting the sense that using any one of these indicators of abnormality may not be possible, but let's go through them. So the third way we could define abnormality is the extent to which a person is acting or talking in ways that are irrational. So does the person act or talk in ways that are irrational or incomprehensible to other people? From this perspective, we'd consider, you know, any behavior to be abnormal that doesn't make sense to us, right? So example, a person who's, you know, very financially well off but still worries constantly, you know, about their finances and perhaps even hoards things, you know, or a successful conservative businessman grows his hair long and starts giving his money away to everyone. You know, these are things that would be sort of incomprehensible or irrational to some people, and therefore we could use that indicator as a definition of abnormality. But the problem with this definition by itself is that it's very culturally dependent. And it doesn't allow for nonconformity, for individuality, independence, individual variation, and behavior. Fourth, we could define abnormality in terms of something that's unpredictable. We could define it in terms of unpredictability. Does a person behave erratically or inconsistently in ways that might suggest there's some kind of loss of control? You know, they might have a feeling or a behavioral reaction that's really disproportionate or out of proportion to the situation or the circumstances to be expected. Finally, we could define abnormality as something unconventional or undesirable. Okay, so from this perspective, we could ask a couple different questions. First, does the person behave in ways that are statistically rare? Right, so as we've discussed in previous broadcasts, behavior can be measured along a distribution. You see the image of the normal curve behind me, you know, where most of us are in the middle, you know, and then some of us fall at either end of the spectrum. You know, for example, we talked about this with respect to IQ. The middle 68% is supposed to represent those of us in the average range of IQ. Those of us down here would be considered in the mentally retarded range, and up here in the genius range. So representing deviance. But one problem with this definition, and really where it breaks down, is that when one considers that there are many statistically infrequent conditions that we see in daily life that are not thought to be abnormal, you know, we have to question this definition. For example, exceptionally high IQ, as we just talked about, or just unusual or infrequently occurring athletic or musical or artistic abilities, right? We don't define these things as abnormal necessarily. So remember Saz's argument, you know, he would say, well, we don't define those as abnormal because we like those behaviors. They bring us happiness or they bring us joy. We only call those behaviors we don't like abnormal or problematic. So second, from this same perspective of unconventionality or undesirability, we can ask, you know, does the person behave in ways that violate social norms of what is legal or morally acceptable or desirable? The advantage of this definition is that it at least places behavior in a context, in a relevant context, you know, to time, to culture, to place. These things are considered. But the bottom line is that the presence of only one indicator may not be enough to demonstrate abnormality. Most of the time, clinicians are using two or more of these indicators of abnormality when attempting to categorize patterns of behavior that they're seeing. In other words, when they're trying to come up with a diagnosis. And certainly the diagnostic and statistic manual of mental disorders does the same. You know, it's looking for behavior that is either causing personal distress, is somehow inconsistent with norms, or is causing impairment in most cases, is causing impairment in some area of functioning for the individual. So this brings us to the last key question of the chapter. How are psychological disorders classified in the DSM? So what is the DSM? The DSM is in its fourth edition, and it is the most widely used system for classifying mental disorders. It's published by the American Psychiatric Association, and it essentially organizes mental disorder by the mental and behavioral symptoms that characterize them. So it's the DSM-5 actually is due out this year, next month in May, and it's going to have some significant changes that are probably going to have some huge impact on the field. But just for our purposes, generally speaking, you know, to give an overview of the DSM, it has two main advantages. Number one, it lays out the criteria for, you know, 300 plus mental disorders. And by doing so, it gives clinicians and researchers alike a common language. You know, we have a method for speaking, you know, about these disorders. So when one person is saying they're doing research on a group of individuals with major depression, testing out perhaps a treatment and seeing if it works to help improve depression, then, you know, other people who are reading that research understand what the person means by saying they are using individuals or studying individuals with major depression. That usually mean major depression as defined by the DSM. Even though the DSM was developed primarily by psychiatrists, its terminology has been adopted by clinicians of all types, including psychiatrists, but clinical psychologists, social workers, marriage and family therapists, etc. Also, most insurance companies use the DSM standards in determining what treatments they will pay for. So that's really important. And that is true, even though the DSM, for the most part, avoids endorsing any kind of theories of cause. It's atheoretical from that perspective. It's not saying why these disorders come about or how they come about. And it's also not suggesting any kind of treatments specific to any of the disorders. So it's really just a syndromal classification system that identifies patterns. So behavioral patterns that can be seen and that have been shown to either cause distress or create some kind of dysfunction in a person's life. And the point, of course, is just to have predictive power. And so that when we see certain kinds of behavioral patterns, we know what we are likely to expect. The prognosis of a person. Is this likely to get better? If so, in what period of time? What kinds of treatments? This is another research aside from the DSM is really showing us this. What kind of treatments would be best indicated for this particular person given their diagnosis? But not just given their diagnosis, because the DSM is actually a system that uses what's called a multi-axial approach. So there are actually five different dimensions or axes upon which diagnosis is made or contextualized. So the primary diagnosis is on axis one, and this is the specific clinical disorder affecting the individual. So whether it's major depression or bipolar disorder or schizophrenia. And then there are four additional axes that provide the context in which the axis one disorder is occurring. So axis two would include any long-standing problems, such as mental retardation or personality disorder. Axis three, any relevant medical conditions. Axis four, any current stressors in the person's life. And then axis five is what's called the global assessment of functioning, a GAF scale that is a number from 0 to 100 that really is an overall assessment of the person, their symptom severity, and their functioning. So what I want to do now is show you a video that is going to provide a summary. I know we've been talking about a lot of stuff so far in this chapter, but this video is going to provide a summary of what we've covered up to this point, from Rosenhan's study all the way up to the DSM. And it ends with an application to hypothetical case examples. So we can go ahead and cue that video.
When you go to the doctor with a fever and a sore throat, he'll talk to you, examine you, maybe listen to your breathing, and he'll use his information to figure out an explanation for your symptoms. This explanation is his diagnosis, which is, in technical terms, his interpretation of the nature and cause of your illness. In other words, what he thinks has gone wrong with you and why he thinks it's gone wrong. The doctor determines that your sore throat is infected, that's the what, and does a quick swab test to determine that it's caused by the bacteria strep. That's the why. Diagnosis in psychology is the same thing. If you think about it, though, it can be a lot harder to figure out what's going on in someone's mind than what's going on in their body. You can describe to your doctor that your throat is sore, and he can look at you and run tests to figure out why. But if you're depressed or if you're suffering from hallucinations or delusions, your description of your own symptoms can be more difficult to follow and interpret. And there's no equivalent of a throat swab to test for depression. Now, over the years, psychologists have worked really hard to figure out ways to improve diagnoses. Psychologist David Rosenhan suspected that psychiatric hospitals often gave patients the wrong diagnosis. To prove it, he decided to send in pseudo-patients, including himself, to test the doctors and nurses in the hospitals. These healthy people pretended to be mentally ill by complaining that they heard voices. Once admitted, these pseudo-patients acted normally and said that their symptoms had stopped. Even so, they were not released and were not identified as having faked their symptoms. Now, after Rosenhan announced these embarrassing results, one prominent hospital asked him to send them some pseudo-patients, confident that in their hospital, the pretenders would easily be identified. Following the challenge, the hospital identified 48 pseudo-patients out of the next 195 people who were admitted. But Rosenhan hadn't actually sent anyone. Now, interestingly, the actual patients in the hospital were suspicious of pseudo-patients. It turned out that patients were actually better at identifying pretenders than staff. Now, experiments like Rosenhan's show how difficult it is to come up with a reliable scientific system of diagnosing mental illness. For this reason, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, known as the DSM, has been undergoing constant revision since its creation in 1952. The current edition is the DSM-4. The DSM-5 is due out in 2013. As psychologists grow in their understanding of symptoms and disorders, they've changed the DSM in order to make it a more effective diagnostic tool. One of the most notable changes to the DSM was the removal of homosexuality from the revised edition of the DSM-3. It had been listed as a disorder since the first edition, but it was removed because that was no longer considered to be a disorder. The current DSM-4 uses a system of 5 axes, or categories of things, for the therapist to consider when making a comprehensive diagnosis. Going through those axes and what kind of things a therapist marks down for each of them can help us get a better picture of the many factors involved in psychological health. Axis 1 includes clinical disorders, some of which you've probably heard of, depression, bipolar disorder, anxiety disorder, anorexia, and schizophrenia, among many others. Developmental or learning disorders, such as ADHD and autism, are included here as well, as are substance abuse disorders like alcoholism. Now, Axis 2 is for intellectual disabilities and personality disorders, such as paranoid personality disorder, borderline personality disorder, and many others. Axis 3 includes acute medical conditions and physical disorders. Since some conditions can affect mental health, therapists record them as a part of the diagnostic process. Axis 4 is where therapists can note social and environmental factors that contribute to a person's overall mental health. These could be things like negative life events, stressful family relationships, or inadequate social support. Axis 5 is known as the Global Assessment of Functioning. Therapists use this assessment to judge how well a patient carries out the activities of daily living on a scale of 0 to 100. This completes the patient's psychological profile. Even though only the things listed on Axis 1 and 2 seem familiar to us as psychological problems, all of the information from these axes is important to the therapist when making a diagnosis or planning treatment. As an example, let's consider two patients, Wendy and Emily, who have both been marked as having major depressive disorder on Axis 1, which was the clinical disorders. Now, Wendy's home life is fine, but Emily's sister has just been diagnosed with cancer, and it's put a lot of stress on her family. Emily's therapist would code this major life event and stressful family relationship on Axis 4, which was the environmental factors, and takes this into consideration in Emily's therapy sessions. Wendy's depression and Emily's depression likely have different causes, which the therapist determines by looking at the bigger picture. The DSM actually contains no recommendations for treatment or information about causes of the clinical or personality disorders listed on Axis 1 and 2, because the information on the other axes informs the therapist about both. The American Psychology Association says specifically that the DSM is meant to serve as a convenient shorthand for psychological professionals to communicate with each other and reach quick categorizations, rather than a how-to book on fixing patients. So we've learned about the difficulties of psychological diagnosis, the Rosenhans experiment, and the evolution of the DSM. Categorizing, diagnosing, and treating mental illness isn't a black and white process. It's important to keep it in mind that while the DSM serves as a guide to therapists, it's not the be-all and end-all of treatment.
Okay, welcome back. So the rest of your chapter reviews the major classes of psychological disorder that can be found in the DSM, including mood disorders like depression and bipolar disorder, the anxiety disorders, somatoform disorders, dissociative disorders, psychotic disorders, developmental disorders, personality disorders, and adjustment disorders. I'm actually going to put some educational video links to short lectures and case examples online so that this can supplement both your readings and this broadcast. But for now, let me just talk a little bit about mood disorders since we still have some time. Basically, when we think about mood disorders, we're talking primarily about major depression and bipolar disorder. So everyone experiences changes in moods, right? We all have our kind of ups and downs. When we talk about a mood disorder, we're not talking about normal variations in mood. We're talking about something, a mood change that feels out of control, that feels extreme, or that might lead to extreme distress or some kind of impairment in a person's functioning, or a reaction, an emotional reaction that seems inconsistent given the person's set of circumstances. So normal depression occurs in response to a bad situation. Right? It's normal to feel down sometimes. Sometimes people forget this, I think. But major depressive disorder is a condition in which these feelings remain for weeks, months, long after, the situation or the depressing event has passed. So there are certain symptoms of depression that I want you to be aware of, right? Certain symptoms could include depressed mood or feeling sad, feeling down. Significant reduction in one's interest in activities that they once enjoyed. Loss of interest or pleasure, in other words. Significant weight gain or loss. Trouble sleeping, so getting not enough sleep, or sleeping too much. Fatigue, feelings of worthlessness or guilt. Problems concentrating, and sometimes people can have thoughts of death, thoughts of hurting themselves. The DSM requires 5 of these symptoms to occur within the past 2 weeks to diagnose what's called a major depressive episode. Women are more likely than men to be diagnosed with depression. I want to give you a quick sort of case example of some of these symptoms and how they can emerge. So there's what's called a more of a vegetative kinds of depression where you're going to see a lot of these physical kinds of changes that I just mentioned in the presentation of the person who has depression. So we can go ahead and cue this video.
I want to understand more exactly what you mean by feeling depressed. What does depression mean to you?
Physically, I'm lethargic to the point of not wanting to get out of bed, mm-hmm. not wanting to shower. If my children aren't home like they've been in college, I sometimes stay in bed in the past for a couple of days, mm-hmm. on and off. If I'm not working, and I can do that. I feel like my arms are so heavy, I cannot lift them. Mm-hmm. If I can move myself to the couch downstairs and turn the TV on, that's like a big deal. Mm-hmm. And then it's so bad that I won't even get up and change the channel, nor will I get up and get the remote to change the channel.
Okay, so that gives you a sense of the severity that we're talking about when we talk about mood disorders, not just feeling down. Bipolar disorder is another mood disorder that involves rapid, not always rapid, but at least swings or shifts in mood from depression to what's called mania. So by definition, bipolar disorder includes either a manic or a hypomanic kind of episode. What a manic episode is basically a time period in which the individual becomes euphoric, hyperactive, you know, very talkative, emotionally wound up, kind of like a natural high. And, you know, this oscillates with periods of, in many cases, depression, where the person will go into just the opposite emotional state, which usually characterized by despair, worthlessness, and the symptoms that we've already talked about. There is a genetic component to both disorders, but there's stronger evidence for a genetic component in bipolar disorder. So what we're going to do is end today with a case example of a gentleman named Todd who's diagnosed with bipolar disorder. So this was the case I referred to earlier when I said, well, not everyone feels distressed by their particular mental health condition. So this is an HBO video. It's going to be shown in three parts, following Todd through a series of experiences. And I'm hoping that this really helps bring to life some of the material we've been talking about today. So we can go ahead and cue the first part of this series.
Like I said yesterday, all I wanted them to embrace me. I was like, I'm lost because people in here don't accept me and people out there don't accept me. It's like the only one that accepts Todd is Todd. As I can see society, you know, and they're just like this. That's keeping me from them, you know? It's like I'm in a glass cage looking out at them and I can't be out there with them. You know?
I know what it is. They come over there.
This doctor thinks there's this voice in my head named Andrew, you know, that's telling me to do all these things, you know? It's like, she's supposedly my doctor, you know? And you see the big doctor-client trust we have.
If he goes back out in the streets untreated on the wrong medicines, that he's in danger of hurting somebody pretty badly. Whereas and the interesting thing is when he did take medication, that he was in much better shape.
There's a state law, I can refuse medications. Medication? Medication? She basically wants to get me on four different drugs, and I don't want that to happen. You know what it's like to take Tylenol? Do you know what it's like to take some of the other psychiatric drugs they give you? It turns you into a zombie. You sleep 14 hours a day. You can't sit down in one spot. You can't sit down in one spot when I was on Tylenol here for 15 minutes at a time. You get so jittery, your hands clamp up. Give Todd a break. I'll be out of Massachusetts here. Just let me out of those doors. I'm going back to Fort Lauderdale, Florida to enjoy paradise like everybody else that lives down there. You know, all those rich people that got all those boats, those yachts, and they got names for their yachts, you know?
You're not gonna have that though if you go?
I won't have a yacht, but I'll have myself, and I'll be free, and that's what I'll have.
John, there's a spider right here.
Cowboy Paul. Cowboy Paul.
Okay, so it's time to end for today. We will come back to Todd during the next broadcast where we'll also talk about treatment of psychological disorder. I'll see you then. Oh, it looks like we are still taping. Okay, so I...